So today we're going to do the big honing film, and I'm doing this together with Jenny, and I can present you.
Sure, go ahead.
Yeah. I learned you for some years ago when I sold the Nordic snath to you.
My first scythe.
Yeah, and since the last years you have been really, really dedicated, traveling around Europe and Sweden, meeting all the scythe pros, more or less.
Well, I have some on my bucket list still, but yeah, I'm working on it.
Yeah, you've been a lot in Austria?
Twice, but yeah, after COVID I'd like to go back. Mm. There's something to be said about a country where the scythe culture hasn't died out and come back, where it's, you know, sort of stayed alive, mm-hmm. you know, compared to the Nordic countries where it sort of went away and now we're sort of reviving it.
Yeah, it's really reviving, yeah. And you also have started to hold your own courses a lot?
Yeah, especially this year. I started a little bit last year, but mm-hmm. I'm like a new scythe instructor.
Yeah.
And that's why I'm training with a lot of, you know, you guys who have been doing it for a while, so that I can just learn from each and one, you know, each person to see, you know, your different styles. Mm-hmm. Because everybody has so much to say and their different techniques. And at first I found it confusing, but, you know, by just listening to everybody, I feel like you get sort of closer to the truth.
Yeah. Yeah. And the truth is... it's a really relative, because the more you learn, the more you know that there is no, maybe not that single truth.
Exactly.
And you should definitely not take someone so serious who doesn't seem to be so good at this, who really claim that he tells the truth about how to hone or how to hold the scythe,
yeah.
or anything, or what snath is the best. So...
Yeah, that's what I've sort of realized, is that there are many different ways to achieve the same result.
There are,
yes,
definitely.
And that's what's so fun. So I just like to learn the different ways now. I don't see them as one being the right or the wrong one. It's just different ways. And that's good for everybody to know, I think, is like, you don't have to do it exactly the way... You know,
no.
The master does it, as long as you get there. You know?
So we're going to show two ways, actually, this film. But first, we shall talk a little bit how am I.
Yeah, yeah.
So I've been working with the scythe for, I think, 15 years. I'm Jan Wester, and I run the company Slottergubben.se in Sweden. We sell scythes and have a lot of courses, and especially we also have this team where we are working with objects for the government, really natural meadows. So we move around 50 hectares professionally each year, and then we get like 100,000 for an object, and the faster we do it, the better salary we do have per hour. So that's why we are really, really are used to working as a pros.
Yeah, I think you guys have mown the most of anyone alive in Sweden, I think. Don't you think?
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, definitely. Yeah, and not only this professional that we move, but also all my garden and all the courses and everything. So there is a lot. For many, many, many times I thought, I know how to hone the best, or what's the best type of the Nordic snath. And then each year I learn to know one thing more at least. So you never get full ended. And this is especially with honing. That the honing is so, 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 so important. You can see people telling that other things are maybe more important with the scything, but honing is so important. You need to be able to drop a tomato on the very sharp edge all the time, even before honing, and it should just go through it.
Yeah, and I'm just at the start. Last year I met you, and you taught your technique, and I've been trying to reproduce it, mowing, you know, last year, but... I think I might have forgotten some things, and I'm looking forward to practicing.
So we will tell you a little bit about today to relearn how to hone like a pro, And then also we will show maybe you more another technique if you don't have the same coordination or if you don't want to use the scythe for so much, then there is another really simple technique. So we could say, yeah, we're going through the honing, and with the honing comes also looking for damages on the edge. That is so important. That's two parts of the same coins, you can say. I can show the honing stones. I always carry two with me. This is natural stones from Austria. This is the fine stone. It's a really, really hard one, called the Mailander.
Yeah, it's the same.
Yeah, it's the double M here. And this one I use for maybe 90% of the time, and the honings. And there is like several hundred honings each day, if I really work. And this certain stone I've used, this is on my third season. So you can see this is really, really smooth, and it has kept its proportions really nice and well. Which means I'm also regard myself as a good honer. To keep it proportions. You can see here it's worn out. That's where I repair the stone damages. Then I have the more coarse stone here. You can see that it's actually worn, but I still have the shape here. But you can see that I've used it quite a lot. But 90% of the honing I'm doing with this one. And that's because it doesn't eat so much of the actual metal. So it makes it sharp, but doesn't eat so lot. So that means I can prolong the time between each peening a little bit. But for the new beginners, and if they don't want to maybe practice with the scythe so much, I always tell them to buy the coarse one, if they only want to buy one, because this always make the scythe sharp, if you do on the right way, of course. But it's really, really much easier to make a sharp scythe with the coarse one. It eats a little bit more, that's the only disadvantage. And if you repair stone damages with this one, it will eat a lot of the metal, and it will eat itself up really, really fast, because it is softer. Also, I need to tell one thing that's really important with this fine natural stone, is that when you bring this up, you need to like wash off the clay here. It's some clay getting on. So if you never do this, it will be like ultra fine, and you will not get the results really. You will not get, it's really hard to get it sharp. So always do a little bit like this, and then start the honing. If it's wet like now, the rain is hanging in the air, one thing that is, it doesn't depend on the way you're honing, you need to clean the blade before start honing, because if there is like debris or from old grass, you can see, it will be, if I just go here and move, so it always looks like this, especially when it's wet. So cleaning this off is really important, because otherwise it will become like a, what do you say, like a film between the honing stone and and the metal, that reduce the how it prepares the metal.
Yeah, and sometimes it's not just grass, it's also soil, like dirt.
It can be, definitely.
So mineral particles on there as well.
So some people, they claim that they need to bend down, put some grass over and clean it this way. That's of course doable, but you need to bend down before each honing. So what I do, I put my scythe here, I look along the edge and put my fingers here on the spine, and go on here cleaning. And what I do then is that I feel if there is any damages on the very cutting edge, if I need to bend it.
Don't and you hurt yourself sometimes when you do that?
No,
because
never.
Because I do.
You do?
Okay. If there is damage.
Yeah, if there is damage.
Yes,
yeah.
Because then if there's grass hiding it, and
yeah.
I do, and you know what, there's a little curl.
Sometimes you can do, but
it's not bad. But there will be blood.
A little bit, but usually if there is so big damages, you usually spot them with your eyes before.
So the important thing with your technique is to look first.
Yeah, I think
not,
so.
Because I use the grass to be safe, but
okay.
I think if I looked first, then I could do, because it is faster, like you say, it's much faster to do it this way. Yeah.
And you always, you have all your like senses with you. You have your eyes, your touch, your feeling. So you do like this, and then switch it. And I'd go with the flat side of my hand towards the edge, of course, so I don't cut myself. Cleaning this way, and then I also feel if there is any damages along this edge, bending up this way. This is much, much more scarce recording that it bends this way. A stone damage, maybe one out of
it's very rare.
One out of 20 maybe.
Yeah, I agree.
I would say so usually it's bending up here, so that's always check before honing if there is any damages, because if you start to hone on a damage, there will be, you will damage the actual thing or very edge you actually needs to get sharp with a honing stone.
And the stone as well, I mean,
The stone, you will see the
scratch it.
Exactly. Yeah. You will see the white scratches on the stones always, and I see them every year as well, of course, because sometimes I'm too lazy to really look for damages. I mean, if you cut really, really fine grass and there is absolutely no stones, you don't, and there is dry, no material on the blade, you don't need to look, because especially if it's the edge is a little bit worn.
Yeah.
If it's close to the next peening.
Yeah.
Then you need to have less carefulness about looking.
Yeah, because if the edge is worn, it doesn't really get damaged, because it's not as thin anymore.
Exactly. Yeah. And if it's really super thin, you could sometimes it's just like a hard herb or something.
Yeah.
It's not even wood. Could be, and if it's in the autumn.
Yes.
For example, if it's a vedklint in Swedish.
Yeah, I don't know the word. Herbaceous plants can do damage on a thin edge. Yeah.
So as repairing stone damages and damages in general is so important, we maybe just start with this one. To do. Yeah. Because there is a certain grip, and it could be really hard to learn actually. Let's see, I have a really used edge here. We can see it's really nice to just do like this on the blade, and you try to scratch it like really damaged here, and you can like throw it on here like this, you see. Here
I'm doing this for students. It's
it's really nice.
Yeah.
So you can see here it's really, really hard damages, and feel it with your fingers.
Yeah, it's curled up.
Yeah, definitely.
Yes.
And this is one of the very big virtues regarding the what is it, slipliar,
the grinding the Nordic style blades.
Exactly, the grinding blades. Because if you hit a stone with that one, you will need to grind all the material down again to the very sharp things.
It takes away a lot of metal just to get, you know.
Yeah. Very, very much. And now this is a really big damage. But when you are a really pro honer, you always take notice about a very, very small one as well. So usually I just spot some, put my finger there, turn it around.
Right. Yeah, because there.
And then
because you can see them on that side, but yeah. You're working on this side when
yeah. Then I do like this. I put instead of having the flat side here, I use only the corner. Yeah. So I angle it up like 45 degrees.
Yeah.
And I have a steeper angle as well. And sometimes my two thumbs is...
So you lean it on your leg as well?
Sometimes I lean it on my leg, sometimes not. It's not so important. But okay. It's the same thing as when we learn to hone,
yeah.
That I'm working here about... one honing stone ahead of my solar plexus,
yeah.
That because and with the more or less horizontal underarms, maybe a little bit raised, yeah. But not much, and then I press it like here, and it's like carving a little bit towards you when you carve towards your thumb with a knife, carving yeah. Knife. It's the same moment, and it's like circulating a little bit like this. Could have one thumb on either side, or both thumb in front. And then press. So here, let's see what happened on this damages here. You feel? It's like totally repaired.
Yes. Pretty much back to normal.
Yeah.
What could happen? So if your edge was thinner and you got this damage, would some bits sometimes fall off when you do this? Or
yeah, sometimes you can also get like a curl that it's
oh, yeah,
a twisting.
I've seen that.
Yeah.
Yeah,
and then it's just to you need to just move them away and
yeah, so it falls off.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And then if it's a really really severe damage on a hard edge that you are. Soon going to peen, then it's yeah. Better to go and peen it instead.
Right.
But you can do this really, really, really much.
Yeah, I feel like this at least, I mean, the problem if you keep it, if you just keep mowing, that sometimes, you know, you get grass stuck in it and stuff. So like it even if it makes, you know, a part of the edge maybe not so sharp, if you just fix it so it's decent, then at least you can keep mowing.
Like yeah.
That, you
yeah.
Know, that's my experience. Like, because if there's a little thing here, like a little curl, the grass will snag in it. And,
yeah.
And
yeah,
it will drag along on the site. Like, the
yeah.
Whole time you can't get it off. And,
yeah. Yeah. So what's important is to always have this feel that it's really, really straight
yeah.
Here all the time.
And I think this thing that I said earlier about hurting yourself is it has to do with speed as well. So like if you don't move too fast, you won't cut yourself if there is a damage.
No.
Because if you're going slow and there is a damage, you will feel it and stop.
Yeah, yeah.
So you just don't.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And when it comes, if a damage comes upwards instead, like we can try to do that. Ah. Can I borrow your
yeah.
One? Yeah. Because.
Oh,
yeah, poor blade. You often see them as light reflections. The damages.
Yeah,
that's really good to look for light reflections always. And if it's like this, a super thin edge.
Yeah.
Sometimes you get that it's have been bending, like for maybe 20, 30 centimeters.
Right.
Like that. So what I do quite often on a super thin. When it's just after peening,
yeah.
So I go just with one thumb, the same really steep angle, and I just go like this, very very
the
soft.
Whole thing, yeah.
Yeah, more or less along the hole, just to get it not bend down a single.
But I'm thinking if you get this curling of a long part of the edge, that probably means you peened it too thin for the meadow that you're. Mowing.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah, you
it's,
could.
It's an indication that.
That's an indication.
Yeah.
Yeah, of course.
Right.
But as I always say, it's better too thin than too
yes.
Thick, because then you can grind it up to a decent edge. If you always are peening too thick,
yeah,
that's.
I'm thinking like maybe if you get that if you hone with the coarse one and then the fine one or something, maybe you will
yeah.
Just reduce the little finest bits a little bit.
Yeah.
To just
you do. Yeah, because I said that I use this for 90% and you then I can tell when it's the other 10%.
Yes.
And that's just after peening, I usually go with a coarse one until I really do feel it's sharp. Mm. And then I also hone away some uneven terrain here on the very edge. And then if I have a big stone damage repairing, I can go with a coarse one with a really good force.
Yeah, because I mean, once you've bent the damage back, it's usually a little bit blunt.
It can be, yeah, it can be. So that can be good to have the coarse one. And then when it starts to be more blunt and well used, you feel that it loses its sharpness really fast with a fine one. So then you go with a coarse instead and use some force, and you feel, wow, this is nice. And then you maybe continue with a fine one for 10 times, and then you feel that the coarse one again, and then you start only to use the coarse one.
Yeah. And then it's time to peen.
Then it's time to peen. Yeah, exactly. Because then you can't bend it here. And also, if you have a lot of damages, if it's like a lot of, like a small base or so inside, and you maybe think of it's good for doing it with a file before next peening.
Yeah.
Sometimes I use what I call the progressive peening. So instead of go with a file, I go with a steeper angle.
Uh-huh.
And with a lot of force, just the last 30 minutes before next peening, because then I reduce it and I make it more even.
All right, so now we've got the damage.
But we have the damage,
going the other way then.
Exactly. And then I take using one corner and using this thumb here.
Well, you know, both these movements that you've shown are like, you know, carving in wood.
Yeah.
It's just, it's the two different grips, right?
Yeah, it's the two different grips. Exactly.
It looks like wood carving.
That's a really good metaphor, because this is exactly what you do when pushing it away from you when wood carving. Yeah. Nice. So we've gone through that it's important to wash this off a little bit and to repair the stone damages.
Yeah, so now that's all the things that you do before you actually start honing.
Start honing, yeah. And maybe this is very complicated, but in fact it goes really fast. So maybe it's time. I can just show one professional honing. So you see, so if I come up like this, clean, and maybe I take these two fingers back to feel. And then it's time for honing. And then I do like this. And then I can trust myself and think that it's sharp, and then I can just go on. Or sometimes, even actually quite often, me also as a pro, I go over with my fingers, because this is the way I regard, at least, is the really, really best way of feeling that it's sharp. And sometimes also me as a pro, I need to do it, because I can feel there is maybe 10 centimeters that is not sharp.
Yeah.
And I can only discover this with really feeling. That's the only thing. If I move, it just feels pretty sharp, but I'm not noticing that this is not full sharp.
Right.
So and this moment is a little bit like this.
Yeah.
But it's only with these two fingers.
You're snapping them.
And what's happening is I press actually the sharp edge a little bit down in the nail.
Yes.
It can sound brutal, but that's the way things are. And then when you move the nail away, you're draw the edge out from the nail. So that's why it feels sticky or gluey.
So, and when it's sharp, it sticks.
It sticks.
And when it's not, it just bounces off. Or
yeah, exactly. And it bounces off and glides, maybe. So
yeah.
So it should really feel like plastic, gluey. Have you? Yeah, you have done it?
I did, well, last year, but I haven't. I've usually just sort of felt it a little bit.
Yeah, that's another way. Yeah.
Yeah, but this thing with checking the whole length. it does make sense, like you say, because there might be a part that I haven't gotten, you know, to hone correctly, because of course there are different angles of the blade, so if you sort of hold the same angle the whole time, you might do it incorrectly and
exactly,
you know, at one part. So I don't know if I can feel the stickiness.
Yeah.
My nails getting...
But remember to not have them separate, but just make this...
it feels like I'm gonna hit the skin here. This takes some... I mean, they're so different in length.
Yeah.
Okay. You're sort of the same.
Yeah, this okay.
Doesn't, this
doesn't... Oh, look.
I'll have to reduce the length. But I can, I mean, I get the idea.
Maybe you should angle them a little bit.
Yeah, true.
Like that, yeah.
I can feel that they stick, and and obviously if I knew how to do this properly, it would be much faster.
Yeah.
But I get the idea, and I think I see the point of doing it sometimes, just to check that I'm not missing one part every time I
exactly,
hone.
Exactly.
Then I might need to do some work there, yeah.
That takes it into another discussion. That's for example on this G4000 blade, we always recommend that you, when honing, you would use this spine as a guide.
Yeah.
So spine and the edge. So this is really easy. But actually here, it doesn't hit the very very edge here. So here it is actually 12-15 centimeters where I need to have a more progressive angle, actually, not hitting the spine here to get it sharp. Yeah. So that's small things you really need to look for.
And it has to do with the curvature.
Yeah.
And not the width that I said, but it's.
And it hits here of course.
Yeah.
So that's also how the bevel comes and this what do you say the little tip here. Where the bevel ends.
Yeah, they understand. We don't know.
Yeah, bevel. I would say is
bevel.
Bevel.
Yeah,
okay.
I think it's bevel.
Bevel. Grundegg. Eller?
Yeah. Oh.
We are from Sweden.
Yes.
Yeah. Shall we start to hone, or maybe just tell the basics of the honing? So what actually happens? And what is common to all the honing methods that we know, I would say.
Yeah.
That's using the honing stone, like it will come like here, hit on this spine and the cutting edge, and you need to follow with the honing stone's own roundness. You need to follow all the way down here. That's the way it will come, and on this side you will use the force.
Yeah, because it's like a pair of scissors or something. You've got the bevel on only one side.
Yeah,
basically.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
and here you're just take very smooth, very fine, without force. But you need to come with a roundness of the honing stone, because if you do not. If you just go straight, here you have one good angle, hitting it nice, and here it's too steep. So you will get an angle here. And I would say, not when peening and not when honing, it should never be an angle on this side. Just follow all the way to the very sharpness here.
And if the blade has more of a belly, then you have to consider that. Like it's, if it's more rounded, then it might look like you're making an angle here, but you're maybe just following
the belly. Yeah,
we'll show it in a close up, but
exactly. Yeah, but then it's the last 5 millimeters or so.
I can see sometimes in students they think they've done it correctly, and you can see where the wear is from the honing, and it's like
the
up
scratches.
Here.
Yeah, the scratches. And that's a different sound as well. It sounds more plåtigt in Swedish, but. Like, it's this sound you will strive for. And if you are too steep an angle, it's this. And that's not good. So, soft here, follow the honing stone's own roundness. And here with force, if you need the force. So we'll take the very simple way. I mean, this is a good that way that Jenny will show now. If you want to...
Yeah, sure. I mean, it was... Like Jan says, I've been training with different instructors, and this method was shown to me in Austria as a sort of foolproof way of honing that is very useful, even if maybe you don't continue to use it. It's good to do in the beginning, because it allows you to see exactly where your stone is on both sides.
Mm.
Because all the problem with all the methods when you're standing up is you're not really looking, you know, at the blade like this.
No.
Because if you did, then it would be flopping all over. Like, you're always holding it, you know, like this or something.
Yeah.
So you can't see what's happening on both sides.
No.
So one way of doing it is if you put the tip on the ground and you're then you can see the blade from above, but of course you can't reach it, so you have to go down on your knees. But you're not sitting down like this, you're sort of standing up on your knees. And if I do this, I can see the blade and the edge of the blade, like, all the way down here. So if I do the same movement that Jan showed, I don't know if I'm as good as him, but just, you know, I can see that I'm placing the stone on the spine here and on the edge. I'm doing the movement, and I can see what I'm doing on the other side. And that way I don't get, you know, the angles wrong. So it's, and also I'm holding it here, so I don't have to practice, you know. You could tell that he was moving his hands all along and stuff. Here I can just hold it. I'm not supposed to, like, lean on it. It's not supposed to go all the way into the ground or anything, like, too much. It's just, you just hold on to it here and it's stabilized. You can also stabilize it on your hip a little bit. And then you hone. And we'll see if it goes well. And obviously, if I want some more force, I could move my hand once, just down to here, just so I can maybe be a little bit more forceful. Now, when it comes to the tip, the truth is you don't really use the very tip for mowing, so it doesn't matter that it's not ultra sharp.
Exactly.
But you can, like, squeeze it in your elbow and your armpit here and lift it if you want to do.
Okay,
but it will,
okay,
look a little shitty. So, like, it's just if you really want to. But I thought, you know, it's very good to see what you're doing. So
yeah.
if you feel like you're botching it, then maybe do this. But you don't have to do it on the ground. I mean, you're gonna see when I get up that my knees will be wet. But you could also just put the scythe on, like, a log or a stone wall, or like something that is, you know, maybe this height. I put it like that, and I do the same thing. It's slower, and you, of course, if you're honing, like, every other minute, going down here and doing this thing and getting up again is not practical. But if you're just mowing a little bit at home, you don't really need to become, like, a pro honer and do all the
you don't need, because our aim is that as much people as possible will be sure about or feel comfortable using the scythe.
Yeah, it's not about speed when you're not working as a professional mower. And I mean, most people are not professional mowers, so this is a perfectly fine way to do it your whole life. You could have, like, knee protection if you don't want to get wet, if you want to keep doing it like this, or if you just have a log or something that you can put the blade on. So it's pretty practical.
And then you also use more force on this side, of course.
Yes, and I maybe didn't show it so much, but I can apply more. You can see maybe that the blade bends.
Yeah.
I can apply more force and be, like, a little bit more going straight here.
Yeah.
And then, yeah.
And so, you move along, like, 15 centimeters maybe each strikes downwards.
Something like that, but obviously I'm more of a novice here, and there's probably room for improvement. But I should be doing pretty much the same movement that I would be doing standing up.
Yeah, and then it's like 10, 15 centimeters going ahead each stroke.
With a little bit of overlap.
Yeah.
Right? For each, you're not picking up exactly where you ended, but you start a little bit where you,
And just to claim this, that it's not important which side you start hone on.
No.
Because that's a question that always comes up on the courses. Does it matter if I start on this side? No, yeah, it doesn't.
And also, people ask, do you have to do it like alternately like this? Do you have to do it like this side? Not really.
No, like, you could not really. You know,
everybody does it, kind of, but not everybody. So, like, you could do the whole thing on one side first.
Yeah.
To get it right that on that side, and then do the soft one on the other, and that would also be more, maybe an easier way for you to do it if you're not skilled, and you don't have a tutor there to tell you or anything. Like, then do it the safest way you can think. That might be doing one side first and then the other.
Yeah, and this way is really good. Because it's really secure,
you will not
be able to drop the scythe. It's really firmly stays here. It can't just suddenly move away somewhere.
No, even if it falls, it doesn't go anywhere dangerous. Like, no.
And it's also, you don't need to be doing two things at the same time.
Because
your left hand is only holding that one.
Yeah, and you're maybe moving it.
Like
a little bit, but it's not. You're not doing fancy finger dancing
to get to.
So that's really useful.
That's really useful, and it's really good for new beginners. Even if you want to learn how to do it like a pro, as I will show you soon, but you can start this because you will really get an idea about the angles, following the roundness of the honing stones, and so.
Yeah, and like if you're moving from maybe the beginner stage to a little bit more advanced, then you can use this as a reference. Like if you hone this way, and you can tell like how sharp is it when I hone this way, and then compare it to when you're standing up and doing it, is it the same sharpness or is it less sharp now? And then you need to do something different. And I like the coloration we're getting here. I'm thinking we're gonna talk about the little color from the clay from
the honing stone.
Yeah. We could do that standing up, but I find it's another useful thing to just check your work.
Yeah, especially on this side.
Yes, especially on that side.
Here, because you will have like, it's good to that you have like 5 millimeters where you have seen that you have actually been working here.
Yeah.
And you have scratches.
When you use the blade, it gets shiny on the surface that you most likely, I mean, hit the whole time. When
another good thing to control yourself, what you actually do here is having a big whiteboard pen or so, just mark it up. And then you can see the scratches on that color.
So they were it would be shinier where you used it, but also just when you've honed, there's also like little residue of metal and honing. The whetstone and well water, and it will dry up, and it will be like a white, milky kind of thing. And you can tell sometimes, like if you haven't done it correctly, it won't be visible.
No.
So, for example, if you forget to lean against the spine, if you do it like this, then the residue will be not. There won't be a residue almost on this side.
Yeah, it's just maybe half a millimeter.
Yes, exactly. Yeah,
very nice.
But what you want now is, I've got 1.5 or 1 or something.
Yeah.
Because I've remembered to use the spine as the guide. And that will be the same here. It will be like 5 millimeters on this side, the residue.
Yeah.
So that's also something you can use to check yourself.
Okay, shall we go on to the next level?
Yeah.
And then we will do as I tell them people on the courses.
Right.
Mm. So then we have the wooden honing stone.
Uh-huh.
That's not scratches your hand, and it doesn't damage the blade if someone is doing wrong.
Ah, yeah.
So that's really nice.
Should I put the scythe down?
Yeah, please do. Okay. So we start to, this is two things that you, because your left hand is doing one thing and your right hand another.
Right.
So you can get this one. So first we need to just check where we are actually working. And if you put this in your solar plexus here, so where it ends, that's where we actually always working, because that's where you are strong and relaxed. So that you can relax in your shoulders, you have your underarms straight or a little bit raised, actually usually a little bit raised when you work, but not raised like this. And often you will see people honing up here.
Yeah, I've seen that.
And that's, I mean, if they do it right, it gets sharp, it's good.
Yeah, like we said, there are many different ways.
There are many different ways, but I would say this is a quite a bad way, because you have the sharp thing really much over your head. True. You don't get the force, and try to stand like this for a day.
Yeah.
Or like this with relaxed shoulders. Okay. So that's where you work.
Right.
And then we will grab the honing stone the right way. So put it in your hand like this. Mm-hmm. Close your fingers, close your thumb, and feel that you have a good grip with your little finger. So you shouldn't have the honing stone like this, and not like this either, because you want to use like half of the stone for honing.
Right. So I'm gripping the lower half, but I'm still seeing a little.
Yeah. You do. And if you have really narrow and tiny hands, you might come up here, because you want to have this ring here around the middle of the honing stone.
Oh, the widest.
More or less, or just a little bit downwards from the widest part.
Okay.
Mm. So the thumb must.
I'm gripping with all the fingers.
Yeah. And the thumb must come down, because if you have your thumb here, as very many people ending up have, then you will only be able to use this place of the honing stone. So this must come down. And when you're a skilled user, you will feel that the honing stone flexing like this a little bit.
Yeah.
And now we can hold it like this. So this is just to feel the pressures. You're looking straight into this edge here, because that's the way we are, that's the part we're honing with.
Yeah.
You grab it and you push it towards you with a maybe not so much force, but with little force.
Yeah.
And then you feel that you need to be able to, you need your fingers here to hold the resistance.
I feel even the little finger is working.
Exactly, exactly. And then you push it away instead. So this is a really, really pedagogic way of knowing how to do this. Mm-hmm. And you can try to push it really, really hard. You feel your handle here. Must work, and you feel it touches inside here in your hand.
Yeah.
So when you're honing, the stone will go a little bit, ending in these positions, depending on the side you hone.
And I need to be able to be strong in both directions, kind of, or like
not so strong when pushing it towards you.
Oh yeah,
no, because that's the when you're doing the fine job.
That's true.
But you need to be able to do it strongly when pushing this your left hand away from you
on the bevel.
So that's where you need to be strong.
Right.
And now to start to just learn how to do, you just fold up your hand like this, your thumb aligned with the fingers, pretending this is the blade. Yeah. So and holding it here, one honing stone in front of your chest. Have you start with your handle very straight, not angled down, not angled up. And starting here, you're relaxing the shoulder, you're going back with the elbow and turn this handle up, or the wrist. Handle or wrist? What do you think?
The wrist.
Wrist.
Yes.
We say the wrist. Yeah. Turn the wrist up, angle it up, and going here. And those who do it with some force, so it like, what do you say, slips off with a snap, whip, flip, exactly, flip.
when I do this with a little snap, Is there a risk that I'm blunting the edge?
No. That's a good question, because that question always comes up on the courses.
Like you might
it feels,
it.
But yes. you don't because you lose force when you are here.
Uh-huh.
So just a slight.
So you kind of relaxed the force a little bit when you're when you're down there. You're
exactly, and then we can just go. Then you have your wrist a little bit angled up here, so then you go up on this side on your hand, and feel that the wrist is straight. Then same movement back with your elbow and angle it down instead. Because this, when angle down and angle up, that's when following the roundness of the of the honing stone.
Right.
And now this is important thing, take the shortest way around your thumb.
Ah.
Because many people also ends up here.
Yeah.
And that's by no use.
No.
Because then we just lose control. So shortest way around the thumb. And this thing you can practice until you feel wrist down, wrist up, and back with the elbow. So when we're doing this really professionally, it's like it's like flipping. So you can hear the voice of the honing stones in shong 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 shong.
So yeah, I think I've been doing it more with my arm, and I feel like I'm stronger if I pull the elbow back.
It's using
a bigger part of the arm to do the movement.
It's like, I don't know exactly which muscle, but this here is a lot of the force.
I feel like a lot of the power is coming from there.
You maybe can
kind of
angle this up a little bit more. So you have the
right.
Because I think
that's what where the blade will be.
Yeah. So it's really important that you hold your hand so the wrist is straight. You always start with a straight wrist.
Like 90.
Yeah. Yeah, so you don't feel that you need to start. If you have the hand angled down here, you need to start with a lowered wrist.
Yeah.
So always like start with a straight one.
Keep it like
because
that.
Yeah.
Yes, I get it.
And you can also start to like hone a little bit towards the tip of the fingertips here, because that's what we are doing exactly as usual before.
Yeah. And of course, the reason why I'm doing this with wood is because it kind of hurts when you do it with the stone after a while.
Not with this really fine stone that is used a lot, because this is really soft actually.
But I think on mine it would start to feel it after a while.
Okay, so now we know this. Then we're going, what is actually the left hand doing? Place the snath down here in an angle on the right, front right, placing the blade so that if it had been a mirror, it should reflect like your left nipple or your left part of the throat. Somewhere like this. Of course, it depends a little bit on your body style and everything, but
on your nipple, collarbone, or something like.
And a good snath has a nice edge pointing down here, because then it really stays firm in the ground. Because the most severe honing accidents I've seen, that's when the snath glides away.
Yeah.
For example, if it stands on stone or so, and if you have some pressure on here, it glides, and the same time you are coming up with a hand. That's not good.
No.
Because then you need to go and make some sewing.
So maybe then it's safest to be sure not to lean on the snath.
Not too much. And on this Austrian snath, depending on where you have placed the upper handle, it will rest on this handle or it will rest on this one.
Yeah.
And this is always already a little bit sharp, but you could do it with an axe, making it a little bit more pointing down actually, if it rests on this one. So this hand needs to like move along, because you always hone where your hand is for being strong. For because if you start hone up here, it will just flex. Yeah. So start here, going with your thumb towards there. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Moving your fingers and the thumb, your fingers, the thumb, fingers, thumb, fingers, thumb. Be flexible in your wrist. That's a good one.
Yeah, that's
when you're a
beginner, it feels like you can't, but yeah. I think maybe you have to be a little bit relaxed to be able to even do it.
Yeah. And moving this part of the thumb here, the muscle, you can like bring it down, so you like really lower the wrist like this, because the closer you are the edge here, with your thumb and parallel with the edge here, the better it is.
Oh yeah, because that's where your stone is. That's where your stone is hitting.
Yeah.
I mean the part you want to hold.
Exactly.
So you
use your thumb as something to move against.
Right. Okay. So move the wrist down so you can get the thumb up ahead and keep it low.
Yeah.
Keep the thumb low.
And I'm not stretching the thumb up like this, but this junction is pretty straight. Oh, so it's more like this.
Oh, you're swing.
Mm-hmm. I'm.
I don't know if that matters, like which way you do that. We'll see when I start to use the stone, if it makes a difference.
Yeah, but when doing it many, many times, you will.
Yeah, I think you find the most effective way to.
Yeah, yeah. But my thumb is mainly just gliding here, you see.
Yes.
And I always have this part more or less on the blade.
I would love to paint some eyes and paint it like a caterpillar, because it looks hilarious when you're doing it. I think that video must happen at some point.
Mm. But it's a really about like moving more or less. You use also your arm, I think, a little bit, like bending the elbow a little bit up and down.
Maybe when you're doing it faster, you're probably. Yeah, but I mean, I'm thinking like the most important thing here is that you feel safe in your grip.
Yeah, right? That's the most.
There's no risk of dropping it at some point, and you feel like you're.
And you should never like just lose your grip and let it, so feel like you have control.
Yeah.
And when starting, you always need to like be here, because you need to have free space for the honing stone.
Yeah.
So starting on the actual snath here, on the mounting.
But the thumb can be on the blade, but not the rest, not the hand.
The thumb can be on the blade, but then you need to take it away when come here. So that's the way it goes all the time, that the thumb, one or two times, the thumbs need to go up.
Mm-hmm.
And then you are here.
in the start, yeah.
Yeah. And when combining these things, I show how I do now. Up with the thumb, and here, up with the thumb again. And then it's like, when I hit here, when I start close to the thumb, it's like a signal to the thumb to move forward. So when I move this forward, I come here. Then when I hit my fingers here, and hone under the thumb, I move my fingers. Then here. So you see, it's like a signal to these fingers to move when I hit the fingers or the thumb.
Oh yeah.
So I'm always here. So that's the way it goes. Bum, 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 bum. And you see, this is another good. You need to start close to your hand here, because if you start only here, you will not have the force And
you can only do a short little...
You just utilize a little piece of the honing stone. Yeah. So when moving here, and the shortest way around. So you see, when I come here, I snap it.
Yeah.
It's always, it's here in position. So I go up.
Oh yeah.
And never here, because here you don't have the force. You can't.
No.
Here you need to have the force, sometimes at least, to go with the really force. And then one thing is that if you hold it here, have a firm grip, you have the honing stone, you should be able to lift the whole snath. If you're a little bit strong, I mean, then it's good, you can try and see.
See what happens.
Yeah.
Okay, so.
Yeah, good.
Yay.
Yeah. That's a feeling of that you have control. You can actually lift it.
Because you're gripping with all your fingers and you're. There's
Not said that this is the force you always have.
No, I'm thinking like this, the amount of force you apply when you do this, that can have be about like how, you know, how fresh is the edge, how freshly peened.
Yeah, maybe, like, definitely.
Right?
Yeah, that's
after a while you have to like really maybe work it a little bit more.
And that's the thing you always develop over the years. How much force do I need to apply?
Yeah.
And which stone shall I use? Slowly, you will like program down the app in your head how to do all these movements. And come under the thumb. And feel like this. I will also show the next level of professional peening. Yeah, because when you only do like this, it's a little bit like slow, and you always just go down, just down. I'm working really much with these guys from Montenegro, and I heard they had a different style when honing.
I think
it was so much faster, and it was a different sound.
So I
started to look what are they actually doing, and what was nice to see they are doing really much the same because they are professionals.
Yeah.
They have been grown up with moving,
so they
like
have to be fast.
Yeah, and they always work like this, just in front of your chest, not up here in some way, but here, really relaxed in your shoulders. But what they do is like they come up, they throw on the honing stone here, coming up a little bit, moving upwards and then down. Upwards and then down.
I've seen this on a guy from Croatia helped me hone my blade when I was a beginner, and he did this. But of course he did it at lightning speed, so I couldn't learn it, but I've seen it and it's really impressive.
So when you really feel that you control this first level, doing like this, you feel that it comes natural, bending upwards and downwards with your wrist, then can be interesting, start to like throw on the... Still moving the wrist a little bit, but what's happening is the honing stone itself, when you're holding it pretty loose, it helps you a little bit also to coming in the right position.
I'm thinking this is not for beginners because you're moving toward the edge with your hand.
Yeah.
So like you have to really know where you are with your whetstone. I mean,
exactly.
And of course the problem is you always see it done fast, so like, but there's nothing with honing that gets better when you do it faster, except the speed. Like
it's
like if you need to be fast, it's good to be fast. But
there's
nothing quality-wise that improves from speed. So maybe with all these things that we've shown, just try to keep it at a pace where you can control it.
Exactly.
Because
exactly.
It really has no effect on quality whatsoever, how fast or slow you do it. So that's,
and,
I think it's a point to make because some people, I think the problem is with some people when they're teaching it is. Sometimes it's so sort of stuck in your in your muscle memory, you don't even know how to do it slowly anymore.
No.
and that's but it doesn't mean it's bad to do it slowly. It's just that they've sort of forgotten what they're actually doing, because it's just, it's a movement that they know.
For me, it's a really nice to do it with the left hand, with a left snap, because then we don't have it, but then I really need to think, what am I actually doing here?
Yeah.
And wow, is this a new beginner's, and I need to do it slowly. And wow, what angle is the wrist?
I can imagine.
But that's really cool for me to get a little imagination of how it is to be a new beginner. Then still, I know exactly how it should feel. But when you are moving a lot day after day, it doesn't take too long actually, because until you have the speed.
No.
I can hear it on my kids, for example. They have been start. They shall not start to move with a sharp scythe until they are big enough. So they have been. They need to wait until they are 4 years old, and with honing until they are 10 years.
Right.
But now both of the kids, they have moved here, for example, this day. You can hear them.
I mean, I think the important thing is to speed up when you're good, not before.
Exactly.
So because I feel like it sometimes can become like a show-off type thing that people are doing to be cool, and because everybody can hear it. Like if you're in a team of mowers, everybody can hear how fast or slow, how slow you are, and you might feel a pressure to be fast, but. Don't.
Yeah. No. Don't. I mean, exactly. Until you have control.
Like, maybe I'm becoming. I have an okay speed. I'm not as fast as him, but I just feel like if I go faster, I risk hurting myself because I don't see where. I don't know where my hand is.
Mm.
So it's just.
And just a normal honing is. I would say, maybe 15 to 20 strokes.
Right. That's.
And also, we haven't discussed how often you should hone, but I would say it's like every second minute, because you will move so much in the low grass where there is stones and dirt and things. You will wear this very, very cutting edge very fast. And if you're working day after day, professionally, 8 hours, it's like you need this very short pause to get it super sharp again, because you should hone when it's not blunt. I mean, it needs to still be sharp when you hone the next time. You will never lose the sharpness. And then you can just make underhålls.
Like maintenance honing?
Exactly, maintenance.
Yeah, instead of doing it when it's gone bad, you do it before it goes bad.
Definitely.
So that's your style, because you're a professional mower, and I think, I mean, maybe I wait. I do it maybe 5 minutes or something.
Yeah, that also, of course, depending on which speed you have and what how much you press the blade down in the ground.
Everything, of course, but
you never hear anyone move too often. That's super rare.
That's true. So, I mean, and I think that's something like I'm gonna keep testing. You know, what do I prefer? Do I want to move on to just doing maintenance honing so I never get the blade to be blunt? Maybe that's a better style.
Yeah.
So I'm gonna try different versions of honing.
Always maintenance.
One thing that I notice is like when you're mowing like really really dry stuff.
Yeah.
Then you have to really do it every second minute because it just slides off like everything. Like it.
Yeah, but that also shows the importance of honing often, because the edge, the cutting edge, will be equally blunt if you're moving in this type of like wet, nice grass.
Yeah.
But you will just need more force.
Yeah.
And the result is not as good as if it would be super sharp.
That's true.
So you that. When you move a lot, you need to move with less force, and that's the most important, to be really really interested of this area here that is 0.5 millimeters thick, wide, and maybe 65 centimeters long.
Yeah.
And really really keep the maintenance here and your interest, your focus on this That's the most important thing, once
I think. And I think if you haven't taken a course or you don't know, like you don't have a reference point at all, I would say like if, when a site is like well peened and well honed, you should be able to sort of pick out a strand of grass.
Just one piece of grass. Yeah, like this, for example.
Maybe not if it's like this short, but just like a.
Well, we can have a look. Can we zoom in on this one here? So. If I come here, so.
Did you hone it? No.
Nah, I'm.
Well.
Okay, maybe a little bit more down here. Like that.
Yeah.
Or here. Like this. Yeah.
Yeah, and I mean, even without the. I mean, if you're just going like by the base of the plant, you can just.
With.
It,
yeah.
Like move it like that and make it go, you know, cut.
With no force.
With no force. You just go, you put it on the ground by the plant and then just move it.
Yeah.
And if it falls, then you've honed it and peened it correctly.
Yeah.
So that's kind of an indicator.
We can have a look here because usually when I move, I use a lot of force and it's going really fast. But
yeah, you do.
but I mean, I can just hold this really, really light, and let only the weight of the scythe blade resting down here. And if I just cut like 2 centimeters or 3 wide deep, you see this. This is not how I move usually because I move much faster, but it's this type of sharpness.
Yeah.
And it's no force. I think we have told it all, Jenny.
Yeah. Yeah, because we talked about coarse and fine stones and different methods and how you should hold the stone when you're honing.
Importance of the angle.
And of course, we've got these cups because there's water in them.
Yeah.
We might have forgotten to say that.
Yeah.
The reason why you want them to be wet could be one thing to mention. It's because if you use a whetstone when it's dry, the metal from when you're honing, it sort of comes off and goes into the pores of the stone, and it clogs the stone, and you lose the function. So if you keep the stone wet, the metal particles will just go into the water instead and leave the stone sort of clean.
Mm.
But like Jan said, you could still sort of polish it off a little bit before use when using a fine stone.
And that's only with a fine stone. Yeah.
Another thing, having it wet, is it's a slightly kinder honing, I think, when you use when you use dry.
It's a terrible sound with dry.
Yeah. It sounds like it's painful for the scythe.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's a little softer, the effect is a little softer as well.
Yeah.
But it's mainly to just keep the stones from clogging with the metal. So that's quite important. To when you can tell when it starts to dry, you can hear it on the sound, and then you dip it and keep going.
Yeah.
But I think that's the only thing we didn't mention.
Mm.
We've covered most.
So thanks a lot, Jenny. That was a 1 hour film. Whoa, shit.
Yeah.
but I think that will be the best honing film on YouTube.
That would be
so
nice.
Far.
That
so
would be
far.
Nice.
Yeah.
And I mean, this is just
and longest.
Yeah, the longest probably. But there's a lot to say about every aspect of scything. It's it's both simple and complex.
Yeah,
but
it is.
Most of all, it's a lot of fun.
Definitely.
So I'm looking forward to.